My name is Ron Carrico with the San Diego Air and Space Museum, and today we're interviewing Mr. Kantner, who has a long history involving in aviation. He's going to tell us some stories about his history, and then we're going to talk about his father a little bit, and then we'll go on to more modern things, particularly the A-12 project and the SR-71. Let's talk about your father for a second. Now, your father was a very early aviator, is that correct?
That's correct.
And what's the most significant thing about his aviation history? His license, for instance.
Well, he got his license on October the 11th, 1911. Number the Federation International or Autique International.
Why was it in for NARMCO? When would that have started?
Well, we'll just skip back a minute. I'm an aviation offspring. I was born in the Allison Hospital. My father was working for Glenn Curtis, teaching people to fly, to get into aviation. Well, I kind of grew up in it. We had a machine shop and drafting room in the basement of our home. And I got very proficient at drawing plans and this sort of thing. So when we finally Dad moved out in 1940, 39 or 40, and we moved out, mother and I moved out in 43, and I got, shortly thereafter, after graduating from high school, I got a job at Convair in the drafting room.
Oh.
That's how I got into aviation.
So that was after the war you got into that? Did you know the German fellow, Hans Busch? He worked for Convair. He was an interpreter. He was lives here in San Diego. He was an ME-262 pilot towards the end of the war.
No.
Well, and Convair was a huge deal, so I'm sure.
But Convair was greatly influenced by the Germans. That's where the Delta came from.
Absolutely. Right. Yeah. Okay, so now let's move forward. So you worked for Convair, and how long did you work for Convair?
Well, I worked there on and off during going to school, summer jobs and this sort of thing. And then getting into NARMCO, this is a weird story.
What's it stand for, NARMCO?
National Adhesives Research Manufacturing Company, and Manufacturing Company. NARMCO.
Right.
When
did you start working for them?
I started in 53, but prior to that, I had, being a skier, a snow skier, I had met with some snow skiers from San Diego, and we had been going to Mammoth for years and moved from that location up to Montgomery Field into a brand new research park.
Okay, one of the things that our museum is interested in doing now is finding out about some of the things that we have on the floor or in the museum, where they came from and how it happened. And so you have two significant stories about two pieces that we have in the place, that vertical stabilizer for number 955, and also the inlet spike. Well, why don't you tell us, well, first of all, when you work for NARMCO, you help in the design of the intake spike, is that correct?
That was my program.
Then what year was that?
Well, that was 1965.
Now, when did they, but they started designing the A-12, 1958, 57, 59, somewhere in that area?
October 1959.
So the spike you were working on, was it to improve performance, or they already had a spike?
They had a titanium spike.
They had a titanium spike. And so what were you trying to do?
We were building what was at that time called a RAM spike, which stood for radar absorbing material.
So the idea wasn't to improve on the performance. The idea was to... Yeah, that's a good idea. I'll get it.
When on the J-58, well, let's do a little quick run around.
Yeah, why don't you sit down? You'll still be in the frame of the camera.
All right. When this bird,
hold it up a little higher.
When this bird was the A-11, it became the A-12 when they decided it had to be a low observable. It had to go. The study showed that in order to survive, it had to fly high, it had to fly fast, and it had to be hard to detect. Okay. So this was a round cylinder. This is the fuel tank, and it had a camera, a single camera, and a single pilot. But as you impinge or paint this thing with radar, these chines were asbestos silicone filled with a radar attenuation material.
What was it?
It was a blending of carbon powders in a resin system in a honeycomb.
So the chine itself, besides its shape, whatever is inside of it also absorbs radar.
Absolutely.
Wow. And what does that term chine come from? It's an odd word.
It's a boat term.
Boat term.
Yeah.
Oh. Hmm.
Anyway, so that took care of that, and we did the rudders.
Okay. So the same idea was to do it in some low observable
right.
materials.
Right. And now, so the rudders are as the tin benders, the titanium people at Lockheed Advanced Projects referred to it as plastique with a K on the end. And they were pretty much right, except in the end, these are the materials that made the airplane.
Now, the vertical stabilizer or rudder, as you say, at the museum, it's a very odd material. It's not...
It's fiberglass and... a high-temperature resin system that was developed at NARMCO.
And so that's what NARMCO was all about, was these adhesives that would hold the darn thing together.
You can see there's a file over there that says...
it says NARMCO A-12 support efforts.
Right.
It's the second one from the right.
Anyway, we did four... advanced studies building a reinforced plastic missile body, which was 5 foot in diameter. And that was Lowell's program. And we followed that up with a fin off a Snark intercontinental missile, which was about as high-tech as you could get at that time.
Well, that intercontinental missile, you wouldn't have to worry about low observability, but I guess just heat.
You're worried about weight.
Oh, yeah, okay.
So you're trying to build it light and then heat resistant because it is going Mach plus.
Okay, so let's talk about the inlet spike first. Okay, so the inlet spike.
Okay, so we've got a J58 engine in here that's 4 feet in diameter. 4 feet in diameter. That's the first thing you see. If the spike wasn't there, that was what compresses the air to make the motor run.
Right.
Okay. At my mentor, Henry Combs, at the Skunk Works, called me one day on a secure line and asked if we had been looking at the inlet, and he asked, more or less directed, that I take a look at building the cone as an absorber material to hide the aluminum compressor blades that are spinning. Essentially, it's a flat plate.
Right.
And the radar is looking right at it.
Right.
So we made an attenuator that took, we'll just call it, it deflected or attenuated the radar coming in the front of the engine. And that was the last big radar, low observable thing that I know that was put on the airplane.
So now that was on the A-12?
That was on the A-12. And incidentally, we had been building sets of fins, and we actually built 50 sets.
Well, that's how many airplanes they made. They made 50.
They did, yeah. But they didn't use it on all of them. There were a lot of tin fins, titanium fins.
Right. So now let's talk about the specific one we have in the museum right now, the vertical stabilizer. You apparently found that a few years ago. How did that happen?
This is a real Keystone Cops sort of thing. My company, Composite Development Corporation, developing sporting goods, was up on Convoy Court.
Okay, let's stop for a second. First of all, you worked for NARMCO, then you left NARMCO and started your own company, Composite.
In 1968.
Okay.
And we were up on Convoy Court, so we're right in the neighborhood.
Right.
And being an airplane watcher, airports were open then, and you could go over and walk around and see things. And Murray Goodrich, doctor, dentist, had a hangar out there, and he had air memoranda of all sorts in his hangar. And somehow he got two vertical fins.
You don't know how? You don't know how he got them?
He had Goodrich on Maine, which was a war surplus.
Oh, I remember that place, right.
And so he had contacts in the used surplus industry. And I suspect that he got them sometime, well, I don't know for sure. He either got them before the Aerospace Museum started putting their bird together down at by the bay, at the ramp there, or he got them sometime. Anyway, I can remember seeing him at Montgomery Field, leaning against a trailer or moved to someplace else for 15 or 20 years.
Just sitting outside?
Sitting outside.
Then you're probably one of the few people who would recognize what it was.
At that time there were a number of us that would have recognized, but that's where they were. And then,
do you know which part of Montgomery Field it was on, which hangar?
Do you know where Sleepy Hollow is, down where Buzz's office is?
Yeah, I think
it's down at the southeast corner.
Yeah, okay.
There was a trailer, an 18-wheel trailer, and it was leaning against. They were leaning against that for years, and
with the 955 and the skunk on it and everything.
I never saw that part.
Now the skunk. There's a skunk on it and a number 955, which is
the
telephone.
I recognize that, but where they were leaning against, they might have been covered with a piece of canvas, or the two of them together might have hidden the skunk.
So, but we don't know if that was actually off of an airplane or not. I presume it was, but
oh yeah, that airplane was number four or five, SR-71, and it was used as experimental evaluation. If something new came along, it was up at Pearl, up in the desert.
Groom Lake?
Huh?
Was it Groom Lake?
Oh no, this is just outside of Los Angeles, where Lockheed and
Palmdale.
Palmdale, yeah. It was at Palmdale, and
so anyway, this fellow just got it because it was some sort of surplus. But now there's no leading edge. Was that originally titanium?
No, the leading edge is asbestos.
Because that's gone. You can tell the whole thing around the tail is all, whatever it was ripped off of there.
You've got...
Oh, you don't need to show me. Just tell me.
Well, the fin sits on a tapered metal post that comes up. There's about a 15-inch tall vertical stabilizer.
Right.
And the rudder goes on, fully actuating,
right,
goes on top of that, and it fits on this middle post. And then it has a titanium root rib, and it has some titanium structure around the post, picking up the pivots, the top pivot, the bottom pivot. But then it attaches into non-metallic ribs and spars. And the first 20% is a full-depth honeycomb sandwich. Then it's the spars, and then the last 20% is another full-depth sandwich, and then it has a, what we call a canoe just closing out the top, which I did, and the asbestos leading edge, which was a crystallite asbestos with a silicone adhesive, same thing that the chine are made of.
So the idea, I mean, this is all really, really high-tech stuff for its time, which is now paying off in all the things that we have that are made out of composites now, like tennis rackets and golf clubs and that sort of thing, and baseball bats for that matter.
Yeah, well, I mean, baseball bats and tennis racks and those things have been around for 30 years now.
Well, yeah, well, baseball bats maybe not quite that long, but at any rate,
Easton's baseball bats.
Yeah, right. But I mean, it's more recent. I mean, those things really launch baseballs when you hit them now, more than they ever did before. But so that's why you left NARMCO, I guess, because you realized the potential of using this for things other than military and aviation applications, I guess.
Yeah, we could say that.
Well, I mean, you weren't too concerned about the low observability of a tennis racket, I don't think.
Our contracts were with Wright Field Air, the materials lab. They were the ones that were having us do this exotic, couple steps ahead of anybody else.
So what? But who was actually coming up with the formulas? Was that would they say we need something low observable, please make this inlet spike low observable? Is that how it worked?
Okay. One of our programs, while we were doing these high temperature structures, one of our programs was Project VESA, which was an attempt by the Air Force Materials Lab to build an invisible airplane.
What year?
I've got a file on 56, I'd say. And the physicists, the guys that know everything, but maybe aren't the best structures type people or mechanics or what have you, they've all got it in their head. And in theory, they came up with a concept of loading a foam, a flexible foam with carbon particles, different amounts of particles to get a gradient. And NARMCO, the management had to have super contacts in this field, and I have something I'll show you later. But they came to us and said, "We want to cover this T-33, Lockheed T-33. We want to cover it with 1 inch of this absorber material. It'll be absorber in the center, and you can have a fiberglass skin on one side and a fiberglass skin on the other side. So we've got the sandwich." And here was this flexible foam, like in your sink, you can take it and squeeze it and do all this. But this was an open cell foam, and I've always thought that one of the reasons NARMCO kept me around was that I came up with the concept of how do you get this foam into a 1 inch thick honeycomb sandwich. And jokingly, they were actually talking about training chimpanzees to put the stuff, put the stuff in the cells, as I said. Anyway, we came up with a concept I had been working on the F-111 windshield and canopy. Canopies were getting hot and starting to sag in operation. And so the F-111 had a massive glass. It was a sandwich, an outside skin and an inside skin with a butyrate, high temperature, clear silicone type of thing inside. Anyway, I came up with a process, and we'll go into some other time, for loading the honeycomb sections with this core, and it worked, and we ended up covering a T-33 back at right field. With the absorber. Of course, back then, no one knew anything about inlet ducts or cockpits and the wall behind you on the cockpit and that sort of thing. So our airplane, depending upon its position when it was being searched by radar, would change depending upon the angle of the airplane was flying.
Did they actually fly the T-33 with the stuff on it?
Mm-hmm. It had a 1-inch covering every place. And it was done in the open, and the trailing edge, you've got this F-80 nice aerodynamic airfoil, and you put an inch of foam on each side, and you come to the trailing edge, and you just terminated. So the trailing edge is 2 inches thick.
Did it work? Couldn't you think it would be?
The story was that we'll take it off on the north-south runway, we'll fly down into Kentucky where there's another airfield aligned with our runway, maybe a half a mile off or so. We'll land, turn around, and bring it back and run it back through the radar range. And that's what happened. Gus Grissom was the test pilot, and anyway, it was a 12% return airplane when you weren't looking into a duct or at the pilot or something else.
That was eventually developed into the black covering on U-2s and A-12s and SR-71s, I guess. So what do you call that paint? What's it called?
Iron ball black.
Iron ball black. Now, why iron ball?
The ferrite materials in the paint were spherical, round balls. Now you couldn't see them.
Microscopic, really small.
Yeah, really smaller than microscopic.
And so what happens when a radar wave hits it?
Damn if I know, I'm not a physicist. But
it doesn't return.
It is conducted along the surface. The radar wave is conducted along the surface for some reason.
You mean it dissipates or it?
It. Yeah, it, instead of being reflected back, it is contained adjacent in the outer surface of air and probably just slips off the trailing edges.
So an airplane like the SR-71 in flight, does heat make a difference? The fact that it's 500 degrees, does that make a difference in the paint reflectability?
It does for ordinary house paint. Back when they were playing the numbers game on these things, they painted with house paint and stuff and go fly it, and it would burn off.
Oh, okay. Well, so how much on an SR-71, how much does it decrease its observability? 10, 15, 20, 75%?
I have no idea.
But there must have been...
I mean, the airplane is not invisible. It's just the...
radar.
The RCH is cut down from the size of a swarm of geese to a hummingbird.
Yeah. Well, I know they said the F-117 basically appears about like a BB, but it's got all the angularity all over the place where the SR-71 does not.
Right.
But I guess a lot of the things about it, the way the tails are canted and everything else about it, is makes it low observable. Plus 35 miles a minute doesn't hurt either.
They're used to, out here in across from Admiral Baker Golf Course, just past it, there used to be a radar range where we would test our samples, put them out, and...
Where was it? Just on top of a hill or something, rather? Or?
No, it's down in the valley, just as the road goes, Mission Gorge Road goes mm-hmm. through, you go by the golf course, and of course there are
houses
and trailer courts, and then there's an industrial park.
Right.
Well, I think it's in the 4100 block, and I was going to go down to the San Diego History Museum and get them to get out some pictures back then and see if I couldn't find the name of the place. God, I can't even remember.
So it was just a regular old industrial building. And,
it was
but who ran?
Single story, concrete tilled up.
Did NARMCO own the building? Or
no.
They...
It was a completely separate company.
So did you ever go to any of those tests when they would test things?
Yeah.
Probably wasn't much to see. I mean, they just flip a switch.
And... And you're looking at a cathode ray tube or something, you see something, and then you do your trick, and it disappears. Whatever.
Wow, interesting. Well, now tell me about the spike.
Before we do the spike, let me. You were having fun there talking about going to Edwards. I would get calls to come to Burbank or go to Vegas and get hooked up there to get into Area 50. There's 0.4% of the oxygen at 100,000 feet.
0.4, okay.
0.4 that there is at sea level.
Yeah.
Where the hell did they get the oxygen? They just got to be grabbing it from velocity.
Okay, let's talk about the spike now. So the spike, your assignment was to make that thing low observable. So
right.
Basically, they were going to just make one, but not make it out of titanium. They were going to make it out of...
They had everything made out of titanium at that point in time. And I think they were, I won't use the term desperate, but they realized that the return, as you come over the horizon, doesn't matter whether you're at 100,000 feet or 50,000 feet, as you come over the horizon, you've got these big aluminum fans mm-hmm. turning, compressing the air. The inlet spike is taking the shock wave and moving it up and back so that all the air that's entering the nacelle is subsonic. So if you can just picture you're 300 miles away, you're coming into radar range, and you're just a little, you know, you're a mosquito. But that's what's making the mosquito. Mm-hmm. Without that, you can come another couple hundred miles before there's any sign of you again.
Right.
So Henry said, would we look into it? And I got the program, and this is publicized because there's an SAE report that we put out after the fact, about the time that the United States, everybody was looking at a supersonic transport. And so Boeing and Douglas and whoever, our government was giving them all the information they possibly could. And one of the things they did give them was pictures of this being manufactured. But it was called a radome. It was called a high temperature capable radome. And here's information that you can use for the supersonic.
But it's actually
published in an SAE report that I published.
Let me see.
With a Litvac.
And so now that radome,
a copy of it.
This radome actually goes in the front of the airplane then.
Yeah.
Who's that gentleman standing by it?
That's me.
What a handsome devil, huh?
You want it? That's the original prototype. We took that up to Burbank and put it in an oven and tested it to failure.
How did it fail? Did it blow up or?
No, it probably, I don't really recall. I remember being there and and it had wires attached to.
Well, how could something like that fail? They don't have the capability to make something go Mach 3. I mean, a wind tunnel.
Oh, they had a wiffle tree loading arrangement, and they were pushing, I can't remember on this case, on at all these different points at the loads that they calculated the aerodynamic pressures would be.
Yeah, okay. Okay, now the spike that's in the museum, that was one that you guys made, but it didn't work apparently? Or was it a prototype? And I mean, it's virgin, it's perfect. And how did you find it?
Okay. I forget what the occasion was when Al and I started to get together. I was bringing them some information on the A-12 that they didn't know.
Okay, so we're talking about Al Valdez, who's the curator at the Air and Space Museum.
Yeah. And he said, we were out front, and I was pointing out the stuff on the bird on number 10 out front.
Like what?
The A-12. And
it's number 10 of the A-12s?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's and 11, 12, and 13 became the YFs. Anyway.
Just, sorry to stop you there, but what was the difference between the YF? Did it carry missiles or something or other?
Well, the A was an interceptor. The B, God, what was it? And the C essentially was a prototype for the SR-71.
Okay, the B was the one that had the drone on it, probably.
Yeah, they always had an M number of some sort for...
Yeah, M for mother, and D, M21 for the...
M12 and M21.
Right, and then the M stood for...
mother and...
D stood for drone, right.
Yeah,
real clever
daughter.
Stuff. Yeah. He said Kelly Johnson never called it an SR-71. He just called it the article.
Well, the agency called it the article.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, okay, tell me a minute about, okay, so when you go to SR, or when you flew to we were talking about the darn, I don't want to forget about the spike. So you and Al are talking, and you're pointing up at the airplane, yeah. And what were you pointing out to him?
Well, I was pointing out the chines that... They didn't seem to know at the time that those were absorbers, and both of the fins are plastic, and I couldn't get close enough to see what the spikes on that one are. At the time. But Al said, we've got a J-58 down the basement. Would you be interested in seeing it? On the program, I had no need to know what a J-58 was. There was a need to know. And so you knew the guy's name you were talking to, his first name, generally. The higher up, closer to Kelly you got, the more you knew their last names and stuff. But, so I had never been close to a J-58 other than walking on a hot bird that had been over Cuba, and I got a phone call here saying, be at Edwards at some weird place I'd never been to at Edwards, and in 2 hours, and check out the the fins on that bird. And back then, that's what we checked with, tapping bond lines on the fins to see that they were still, it would go tap, 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 thud, thud, if it was unbonded.
Oh, I see.
Sonic. But this is what we used.
It's a what, a dollar?
Silver dollar.
Silver,
yeah.
Dollar.
and no electronics. And so that's as close as I'd been to a 58, just climbing over the nacelle to get to the part that I wanted to inspect. So when he said, we've got it down in the basement, would you like to see it?
So I this said, has to, okay, so this was in 61. 61 was Cuba.
Actually, Cuba was 3 or 4 years.
Oh, that they were overflying it? So that's when they were flying.
There was a time when, before the J-58s, B-52s, became operational in the 51s, in the A-12.
Right.
There was a time when they flew them with 79s, or I think 79s. And then eventually they added the 58 when we finally got it. And they had one flying with both. But there was a program, it had a code name for using the A-12 or an early SR-71. 71s didn't come out till 74.
No, no.
Or 64.
68.
Sometime.
Well, wait, no, I beg your pardon. It was late 65, early 66.
So they had an A-12
The A-12s flew through all the way through 68.
But
I never can understand why they were flying the same time as SR-71. No one's been able to answer that for me.
My trip to Edwards was to inspect the bird, and they said, be here at 2 hours. And I got in my big engine Chevrolet and drove up and got there, and a hangar way off, no one anything else around it. And I walked in, and everybody was in street clothes, and there weren't a lot of people. And the guy I checked in with, I told him who I was, and he said, yeah. He says, it's out back, I've did a ladder, so you can get up on it. And I went out back, and back then, waffled shoes, soles with convolutions like that were in style. And,
right.
And we used those. And I went out and climbed up on the ladder. I don't know whether we were gun shy or what, but we really weren't looking. We'd been indoctrinated, but we weren't looking for information. So I don't know whether it was a SR-71 or an A-12. It couldn't have been a SR-71. It had to be an A-12 that time, because the word I got before I left was that when they called me, it was over Cuba. So it went from Cuba to Edwards, while I went from San Diego to Edwards. And when I got out to it, it's sitting there just going tink, tink, tink,
cool
tink,
down,
tink,
yeah.
Tink. And then later on, I found out that it had been, as the word was, it was over Cuba. Well, you don't need to go over Cuba. You fly right down beside it. Take a picture, make your turn, come back, and take another picture, and you got it, and you never were over Cuba.
Yeah, I don't know what they did. What? Okay, so now back to the spike that we have.
Okay.
How'd we get it? We know NARMCO made it. We got that part.
Yeah. I'll dig out that file.
Oh, that's okay.
No, I won't dig it out now. We did a structural analysis based on the loads on the tin titanium spike,
right.
And which obviously worked. And we converted that into our materials. And we built the tooling, we did the design, built the tooling, had the autoclave to put it in and cure it. And we We built three. The first one, which is in the picture, which we took to Burbank, to the test facility at Burbank. You've been there, the fort. It's on the north-south runway. And then we built two more. That was the program. And I was up there, and we had a strong back, and we mounted the spike on it, and they had loading devices on the nose, and it was inside a pressure shell, and they pressurized it and heated it. And the way they heated it was using the exhaust from the Buick engines on the starters.
Mm-hmm. Right. What a noise.
No wonder I have a hearing aid. And we tested it. And let me just clarify something. The life expectancy of our parts was 200 flight hours.
Well, that's
okay. So we tested the spike, and I watched the start of the tests and one thing and another, and then came back to San Diego, and we got the word that the spike had failed at 80% of the second expected life. So it was good for the one life and 80% of a second life.
So let me ask you, where was NARMCO located?
At that time, NARMCO Research and Development Laboratory had moved from Five Points. In 1957, we moved up to Aero Court, which is parallel to Aero Drive.
Right.
There's a children's school there right now. And anyway, that's where most of this work was done.
Did it require a clearance to work in the place? A secret, top secret clearance or anything like that?
Yeah. Most... It would depend upon the contract. Most of the stuff, like our big 5-foot missile body, that was not a part of it was classified. You'd put out some of the loads and some of the stuff was classified, but the processing and materials and stuff weren't.
That reminds me, you actually showed me something earlier. There was the patent for the paint on the SR-71. I just think that's so curious.
One of the things that's interesting there is that was all done in the 60s. But you see when it was published, many years later.
Anti-radar means and techniques. Oh, you're right. It was published in 1879, and it was filed in 1967, 13 years later. How funny. Okay, so now the spike that we have, where did it come from? How did you find it? Was it by accident, or?
So Al said, we've got this thing down the basement, would you like to see it? And I said, hell yes. And we went down the basement, and they were actually rolling it outside the building. They were getting ready to do an annual dust off or clean up or maintenance or whatever you call it, somewhere when you're storing something for the Air Force, you have to maintain it. And they were doing that, and the J-58 was on its roll around cart where it always is, but the spike was on a wooden 2x4 cart resting on a sandbag. And I started looking at it, and you know, it didn't take me long to realize that the thing was not titanium.
So
I looked at it, and lo and behold, it is one of the three that we built, and we know they broke one. So what happened to the other two? Well, there was one of them. It had some stuff on it that production spike did not have. That it had aluminum 1-inch patches to conduct lightning strikes.
Shoot. Well, why don't, how did the museum get it? Where'd they get it from?
It came on the J-58.
Oh, so it came with the J-58. Yeah. Oh, okay.
And so all of a sudden, here I am, I'm looking at an old friend. And I emailed Henry Combs, and I said, Henry, I found this spike in the basement at the Aerospace Museum. We built three. We broke one at Lockheed. And I found this other one at the Aerospace Museum. Where's the third? Is it possible that Lockheed decided to build their own spikes? And his reply was, mine's a little hazy. That's halfway back to the rights, but you could be right.
Now this is interesting. This is the anti-radar means and techniques, patent number whatever, July 27, 1967, application number 687472 by the Whitaker Corporation, Los Angeles, California. And it says inventors, Maynard Dawson, Leonard
Sufferdini,
Jake O'Neill, and then it says Converse.
Yeah,
William E.
Those are all Upples. Technicians.
It just says Converse. There's no for. Oh no, it's William E. Converse.
Yeah, Bill Converse.
Okay, and they worked, but they work. It says Whitaker. It doesn't say.
Whitaker bought NARMCO.
Oh, okay. Well, let's do this. Okay, now let's. So anyway, you just when you saw it at the museum, that's you said, hey, that's. Al says we got it with the J-58, and you say, hey, that's the thing that NARMCO developed all those years ago. Huh, how funny. Now, I say, too unrelated to the SR program or anything like that, but you've been to, I've never talked to anybody that's been to Area 51 before. what was it, just a barren desert aviation airport kind of thing, or?
When I first flew into... I flew from Burbank in a Constellation, an early Constellation. It was bare metal. It didn't have upholstery.
So now this is in the late 50s, early 60s, right?
Well, we started in October of 59 on the A-12 program.
And the first A-12s were delivered in
62.
You've probably seen the pictures when they took them up there in those big crates. They have pictures now you can find on the internet. They have the big crates and they're going up there and they had to measure everything perfectly to make them fit over the bridges and all that. Were you involved in that? No? Okay. So when you first went up there, what was...
You would check in at Burbank at ADP, Skunk Works.
What's ADP stand for?
Advanced Design Programs. That's the Skunk, LAC ADP, Lockheed Aircraft Corporation Advanced Design Projects, the Skunk Works. It wasn't in a tent at that time. It was up against the building where they were, the parts were, where the birds were assembled. And you would go around to where a Lockheed Constellation was parked. God, that was a long climb. Connies were tall birds. And you turn in all your identification. Get on board the airplane and fly off out of the area over Red Mountain, 395 Red Mountain, and off into Nevada. And land and go through a briefing, and the briefing was done in a, it was either a trailer or a small barracks type, typical barracks structure. And the U-2 trailer city was out behind it. And, you know, it was like no place you'd ever seen before. I mean, if you got out to a runway, you'd look down it and it would just disappear and over the edge of the earth, so to speak. It was big and empty. Yeah.
Well, didn't they do some atomic bomb testing there nearby? Well,
they had to close the place down a couple times for fallout from some of the bomb tests.
So I can't remember when they stopped the bomb testing. It must have been in 63 or 64 or something like that.
The neat thing about going to Vegas and getting on a EGG company plane, the people that ran the area, you got to fly over the bomb test area.
Really?
And holes, every shape, size, all with umbilical cords running out and down into them.
Wow.
And as people have said, it looked just like the moon. Well, bullshit. The craters on the moon don't have these umbilical cords going down into them.
I wonder if they filled them all in by now, or is it... Maybe the area is still probably pretty hot all these years later.
I would suspect that they're still using them.
So what? So anyway, you go out there and you just hang around and do whatever you were going to do. What would you usually go out there for?
Well, on the first trip, we went out to see what the facility was like, and they had a couple of three-story barracks buildings that they had instrumentation and laboratories and stuff in. I don't recall much about the hangars. There may have been one or two but I do remember, God, it was hot. I remember going up into...
It was summertime then, wasn't it?
Going up into one of these three-deck labs. And up in the attic, they had... They were simulating radar with collimated light. You know, light goes off in all directions. And they were collimating it through blackened tubes so that they had most of the stuff going in a direction. And they were looking at models of the birds at different angles and stuff under black models, looking at where they could see this collimated light and stuff. And as I, that's all I can tell you, except it was hot.
So was the A-12 active at that point?
It wasn't there. No. And then.
So what was the reason you went up there? Just to kind of get a tour of the place?
It's smart to have an idea of the environment you're going to be working in and what you're trying to accomplish and what's available and that sort of thing. Most of my trips were for small details or when there'd be an accident. I've got it checked off someplace. But they crossed the ailerons or something on one of the birds, and the guy with the Russian name... was flying it, and it took off, and it started to bank, and he, of course, countered the bank, and it just made it go faster, and he ejected and went out, and I guess his chute opened just at the time his spurs hit the ground, and he lived through that, but they had the. At that time, I think they had at least four hangars. And in one hangar, they had everything that was left of that airplane laid out in the right position. And we went in and looked it over to see if we could ascertain what the problem was. And then another time, it was really weird. I got called up to take a look at a debris field at Groom Lake, and here is the runway. Essentially, all the damage was from the center of the runway off to the east. And it was all RAM material, composite material, sandwich material. And there wasn't a piece of metal out there. They had picked it all up. And so the Army guys dropped me off and drove me out there and dropped me off and said, when do you want to be picked up? And I said, give me a couple hours. And they were back in a couple hours. But it's lonely out there.
So what? All you found was composite material all over the
just
place.
Chunks of this, that, and what have you.
Well, there wasn't that much composite except in the tail sections.
All the chines.
Oh, right. So, but if the composite is, the chines are titanium, but they have...
No, the beams, the beams that come down and go out
right.
are titanium, and in between there's this asbestos composite absorber.
Okay. So, all right. So the frame of it is titanium, but then right. it has this absorptive material. Right. So they picked up all the metal, the ejection seat, engines, and all this other stuff, landing gear and all that, and all was left was this composite material. But why in the world do they want you to go out and look at it? I mean, that's...
They wanted me to tell them if there was anything I could detect
from all the debris.
Damaged parts
Jesus.
That would indicate that it had contributed to the damage.
Well, you certainly, those chains really could cause aerodynamic problem. You can see that.
Well, the early A-12 had metal panels.
Why did it? Now the Oxcart name comes up all the time. Was that the name of the overall program for the A-12? Did the A-12 ever have a name other than just A-12?
Article.
And the SR-71? I mean, they call it the Blackbird, but...
All of the... That's just the generic.
Hmm. But never really had a name like Albatross or...
Well, at one time, during the design phase, I think it had Signet or something similar to that, anyway, which is Swan.
Right.
Like Swan Constellation. It had some association.
But is the U2 painted with the same stuff?
I have no idea. We started... I have a U2 up there.
Yeah, that's what made me think of it.
The only thing we ever did on that was look at the tail interplane section. It was the big radar return. I mean, that's what you have. If you got a yacht or a boat or something, you got a radar reflector, and it looks just like the tail on a U-2.
Right.
And we looked at it for that. And, of course, as you know, they were running some antennas and stuff over U-2s back then trying to hide them, and it didn't work. But I've just got to imagine. One of the things I remember was we were at the fort testing something or other.
And what is the fort again?
It's just a test facility next to the north-south runway on Lockheed's area there. And I remember they had this big sausage out there bent at about 30 degrees, and that was the fuel tank.
Oh.
The main fuel tank running down the center of the fuselage between the engines. And
so did NARMCO have anything to do with the materials that sealed up the windshield and all the gas tanks and all that sort of stuff?
I had an carte blanche permission to try any sealant that I could conceive of. And the answer is, it's still dripping. Yeah.
Yeah, but it was like the number 6 tank, the furthest one back, which I guess ran out of gas the first, so it got the hottest the quickest. That's what I was told.
Well, that's sure the hot place on the airplane. If you look at that fin from 955, you look at the tail end of it, where it meets the root, the fin where the rudder meets it, the tail end of that rudder, it's almost like it's ceramic. It started out as an adhesive a glass reinforced adhesive. Mm-hmm. Now you tap it now, and the modulus is way up, much higher than it was when it was new.
What does that mean, modulus?
Stiffness.
Oh.
The elastic modulus. And it's almost like the stuff. Well, it couldn't oxidize where there's no oxygen.
Right.
And that's what degraded our adhesives.
The oxygen plus the heat, I guess.
Hmm?
The oxygen plus the heat, would that degrade
right.
it too?
But as I say, the tail end of that, the lower back corner, where it's the closest to the afterburners.
Right.
It's actually in a radiation plume. It's not in an impingement plume.
Wait. A radiation plume. Radiation.
A high temperature nearby shining on it.
Okay. And impingement means? Impingement plume, what does that mean?
Well, that would be fire hitting, impinging
on
the material. It was just a hot area.
I'll check that tomorrow, because I always see that thing there.
You need a
silver dollar? Oh, that's right. I guess I could tap on it, don't I? And if I hear it
it'll be a lower frequency if you tap higher up on it, and the frequency will go up as you get toward that tail.
Meaning it's harder. And the foam is still...
And you'll actually see more glass and less of the polymer that's holding it all together.
Where did they build these things?
I've got photographs of all this stuff. I went out to... I did some research because these places are gone. Our laboratory at Moore Street is under 5. Our laboratory at Aero Drive and Aero Court are gone.
Mm-hmm.
Advanced Structures, NARMCO Advanced Structures, at where 8 and Fletcher Parkway, I guess it is, separate. You go up the hill, and today the trolley runs right through there. It's a big barren area that they say is contaminated by environmentally unfriendly materials, people.
What about, you have a letter up there from Kelly Johnson on the wall.
I have an envelope.
An envelope. Well, the letter I thought was from Kelly Johnson too?
Well, the letter is, but it's a phony letter.
There's nothing on it. Yeah, right. Yeah. So, but you never actually, but anyway, did you know Kelly Johnson? I mean, the obvious answer is yes. But
the important answer here is Kelly Johnson knew me.
Okay.
I knew Kelly. And Kelly had a trust in me that was established working on the program, and the last time I saw Kelly, I was up there for some reason, and Henry Combs was up on the gantry up to the cockpit of an SR-71 that was in one of the hangars. Tucked under a canopy for when the Russians went over. And he signaled me to come over. And so I came over and climbed up the gantry. And I'd never been near the cockpit. But I think he wanted to show me the windshield because he knew of my work on the F-111 windshield and canopy. And while I was up there, I was in front of the driver's seat, forward of that, on the edge of a covering on the chine for some reason, and Kelly's Jetstar landed, taxied up behind us, and pulled in right behind us, and Kelly and his entourage got out, and Kelly came wandering over, and was standing, you know, I'm 10 feet plus another 5 feet to my eyes above him, looking down. And he looked up at me and he said, Kantner, and you never used proper names. He says, Kantner, you got it fixed. And I said, yes, Mr. Johnson, I never called him Kelly. And I was kind of waiting for him to say something. I didn't have a clue what he was talking about. I had no clue. And Bamey, his assistant, came along, tapped him on the shoulder and said something. And they turned around and walked off and got in a car and drove off. That was the last I ever saw Kelly.
What year was that?
He had subsequently a couple of automobile accidents. And
oh, he did? Oh.
One, he was driving intoxicated, of course. Oh. And the other one, he wasn't, and he got T-boned.
Well, he wasn't that old when he passed away. Early 70s, I think, wasn't
it? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and then who took, and then were you involved in the program after he, was it a guy named Rich, was it, that took over?
Ben Rich.
You had a funny expression on your face just then. Why is that?
You've never read Skunk Works by Ben Rich.
Actually, I did. I read that. Yeah, I read that book.
Rich was more of a bullshit salesman.
Oh.
He was a thermodynamicist also.
Yeah. Well, Kelly Johnson had a reputation. He didn't put up with... he didn't suffer fools well, apparently.
That's right. Kelly Johnson and Ben Rich were almost opposites.
Really?
Rich, I couldn't... fortunately, I didn't have much to do with him. In fact, it wasn't until the dedication at the Aerospace Museum in 92... that they, ADP, came down, and Henry Combs and Ben Rich and Henry introduced me to Ben at the time. That was my experience with Ben.
Well, so Kelly Johnson died like in 90 or 91, didn't he?
Someplace around there.
Yeah, okay. So, that's interesting. So, you say the dedication at the Air and Space Museum, when they dedicated the SR-71, I guess, or the A-12? Was that the idea? Yeah, see, that's so long. I don't know much about all that stuff. I mean, I've been in San Diego for a long time, but I've only recently been, the last 3 or 4 years, I've been involved with the Air and Space Museum.
One of the fun things about this is, when we're talking about this with people that don't know anything about it, they'll ask, well, what'd you tell your wife? And I said, I started in October of 59, and it was mid-summer of 92 when I was dedicated. That's 31 years. 31 years, I got to lie to my wife. She never knew what we were working on.
Mm. Oh, really? Wow. Wow. Well, now tell me the truth. You see a little green man up there at Area 51?
No, but I will tell you that there are two other people alive in San Diego that I'm aware of. One is Al Thompson, who was the stretchers man on the Finn. And that was our program 3500, and we did two more fins, I think a 4000 and a 5000, all higher quality for higher performance for a follow-on if there was one. And Al Thompson is alive and lives in La Jolla. He and I went to high school together, and Roland Reed is the gentleman with that radome there, and he had a program developing ceramic tooling to build that is an imidite thermoplastic radome, while everything else we're talking here is thermoset. And anyway, he spent a couple of years doing that, and so those guys are available for.
Well, so in other words, this was a follow-on to the SR-71, which was going to be, what, Mach 5 or?
Oh, no. I didn't have a need to know.
Yeah, right.
And while Revell did have, and they have models of follow-ons, you know. And,
oh, is that right? Wow.
Yeah.
Revell as in Revell Campus, sort of?
Revell Plastics.
Oh, you mean the model company?
Yeah.
Oh.